Hi everyone, I hope you're doing very well. So, today I'm back with another tone analysis. This time I'm hoping to tame the magical beast that is Brian May's powerful guitar sound. Brian May is of course the legendary guitarist from the equally legendary band Queen, and I will be playing some of their tunes periodically throughout this video so you guys can hear the tones in an appropriate context. Little disclaimer, I'm not exactly recreating his tone, I'm just getting as close as I can with what's available to me, which is of course my Helix, plus a bit of research into his live rig and some of my own personal opinion and hearing his tone from ear, making a few adjustments here and there to get as close as I possibly can. With that being said and out the way, let's start with the guitar, shall we? So, fortunately for me, I have this guitar in my collection, and it's the Brian May Guitars Special in natural. I think it's one of the more limited edition colours, I'm not quite sure, but in certain lights it almost does look red, like the original. It is, of course, fitted with these Brian May signature pickups, which are based on the old Burns pickups that he had in his original. And the story goes, of course, that he hand-built this guitar with his father back when he was about 17. Mostly because he just couldn't afford anything. He had to just build a guitar, or that was it. So he innovated, at the time, quite a lot of interesting features, like this wiring system here. Now, this top row of switches here corresponds to the pickups, and it's whether they're on or off. So when they're down like this, they're on, and then when you flick them up, they're off. So it's just an on-off switching system. The other row of switches here flicks each of these pickups in and out of phase. So what you can do is actually achieve quite an interesting combination of sounds, whether you have them all on or some of them on, one of them out of phase, you know, two of them out of phase or whatever. It kind of just opens up a huge range of tonal possibilities. So quite an innovation at the time, to be honest. The other thing to mention for the electronics is obviously just a volume and a tone pot. So nothing out of the ordinary there, kind of just like any old Telecaster, to be honest. Of course, with these guitars being a sort of cost and budget conscious version of the real thing, they have a few changes, mainly this bridge design. Brian May's original guitar has a very unique and individual bridge design, but essentially it works in the same kind of way. You've just got a floating bridge, so you can do a lot of interesting whammy bar tricks and all sorts of nonsense, as well as some subtle chord vibrato, which is how he would often use it. You've got a 24 inch scale length with 9 gauge strings, so you've actually got quite a slack feel here, which I guess for me, as I'm playing any of his stuff, kind of translates pretty well. I can understand why he'd go with that sort of setup, because it does feel really nice and sort of loose and quite responsive under the fingers, along with 24 frets for a bit of extended range. Very nice. I guess the other thing of note to point out is the zero fret here by the nut, because that kind of just makes all of your open strings sound like they're fretted notes as well, which I guess means a more consistent sound from open strings to fretted strings. And this guitar body, like the original, is actually chambered, which, you know, for anyone that doesn't know, parts of this guitar body are actually hollow on the inside, right? I don't know if you can hear that down the mic, but yeah, the reason for that, I think, was that originally it was supposed to have an F-hole cut out, like you see on violins or cellos or anything like that. But I think they decided against it in the end and just decided to cover the top instead. Still a very nice looking guitar though, let's be honest. Mine does have a couple of dents here and there because it is second hand, but you know, to be honest, it was a good deal, so I couldn't really turn it down. And if anybody's wondering what these are doing on here, these are just some Graftec saddles that I fit to most of my guitars just to limit string breakage. And it kind of helps with the tuning stability as well, I think. One other thing that makes Brian May a unique guitar player is the fact that he plays with a sixpence coin. Now, of course, I'm like most of you out there, I use a pick. I think Brian liked the sound of using a coin just because of how the sort of metallic tone would come through on the strings and you could get a bit more sort of crunch and bite out of it. Of course, the serrations on the edge of the coin would also have an effect on that tone. He would like to use that to get a bit of a spluttery sound. It's very innovative yet again. Now I'm going to show you guys the difference, particularly at low volumes in terms of how the tone and EQ is affected, between using a pick and using a coin. When the guitar is isolated like this, you can really hear the difference, the massive difference, between the guitar being in phase or out of phase in certain pickup positions. Now, while that might sound strange by itself, quite a harsh, sort of screechy sound, just put it in context and you'll see why it works so well. Now, I think a point that's going to be made time and again throughout this video is that this sound is really designed perfectly for a band setting. It's not a sound you necessarily would use by yourself and think sounds amazing, but in the context of a band where a guitar finds its place in the mix, it works perfectly. So, let's look at the Helix preset to see what I've got going on to help me get that sound.
Right, I've got the Helix preset loaded up here for this tone. And for any of you that are looking at this and sort of thinking, oh, there's quite a few bits and bobs going on here, quite a few parts to this, it's not quite as complex as it seems, and I'll take you through it at a step at a time just so you can see what I'm talking about. What we're focusing on here, though, is just the key parts of the rig that make a big difference to the overall tone. So things like volume pedals and solo boosts, I'm going to sort of glide over because they're not completely essential to his sound. So first of all, let's look at the amp settings here. Now, Brian May is a very well-known Vox user. He uses three Vox AC30s in a live rig, and he sets them up in a wet, dry, wet configuration. And put in very basic terms, that means that he has a central amp that has a sort of dry tone. There's no effects colouring the sound of that amp. It's just the raw core tone. And then either side of that, for the left and right, he'll have things like delays or echoes, which will be sent to either side. So, you know, he'll have one echo at one speed in the left hand and another echo at another speed in the right. And that gets replicated through his monitoring system on stage as well. So he'll have that coming through his fold-back wedges in the same kind of configuration. And apparently, you know, when you stand on stage and hear that, it's quite remarkable the sound you can get. Now, I may be wrong in this, but I remember hearing that Brian May was one of those sort of classic old rockers that would kind of turn everything up to 10. But in the case of me trying to get this tone with the Helix and this particular AC34 normal channel, I thought that just a few adjustments of my own, again, a bit like the way I handled the John Mayer tone I was after, I just made a few adjustments to my taste to try and get as close as I could with the Helix. And these are the settings I stumbled upon. So, yeah. And for anyone who's interested, this is what the attached cabinet, speaker cabinet, because it's a sort of amp and cab simulation, much like the way that the Vox AC30s that Brian May uses are combo amps. I decided to put these together as well. So you have the amp and cab combo. And when I looked at pictures or video of his live rig, it seems at least sometimes he was miking it up with a Sennheiser MD421 mic. So that's what I've gone for here. Just an inch away, not much else to it really, just a pretty standard setting. Moving on to the very, very important piece of his tone, which is the treble booster that he puts right at the front end of everything in his signal chain. So right as soon as he comes out of the guitar, he goes right into a treble booster. And this is so core to his sound because it already takes the quite hard-working tone of the Vox amp, at full gain and full whack essentially, and then just sort of pushes it over the edge, so it really starts being a saturated screaming sound when you're at full volume on the guitar. It's been so core to his tone for such a long time now that these days while touring he's wearing the treble booster as a sort of pack on his guitar strap, so it's not even, you know, a pedal effect anymore. He's got it attached to his actual person. Something really worth pointing out with Brian May's whole transition from clean to driven tones is that it's all controlled solely by his guitar volume pot. Even with the treble booster on, he can get quite a clean sound. Now, another integral part to his tone is the chorus. And the chorus he used, at least initially back when he started out, was a Boss CE1. And they're quite rare these days because they're such an old model. And the Helix has done an attempt at modelling this in terms of the 70s chorus that it supplies. Now, what the chorus does for Brian's tone, at least in a live setting, is it kind of replicates the sound of a doubled guitar track. That's a technique that, well, not just Queen, but many rock bands in the day would use to give themselves a bigger guitar sound. You just sort of thicken it out with multiple layers of guitar playing the same line. Now, the chorus and the way it works is it kind of splits the signal in two. And ever so slightly, we're talking infinitesimally small amounts here, but ever so slightly delays one of the signals so that it becomes a bit sort of shifted and wobbly and the pitches don't quite match up because they're just slightly out of time. So you get this sort of watery sound. But what that's doing is also kind of replicating the way that a double track guitar track wouldn't be exactly in time. You could get it pretty dead on, you know, play it at the same time to the best of your ability, but it's never going to be, unless you surgically go in and put it on the grid, it's never going to be exactly in time or exactly the same pitch for that matter. So the chorus is kind of doing that, and it certainly gets you on your way in a live setting when you're trying to thicken out your guitar sound.
Get your big tail down and get your arms in, baby. Come and try to get right and go my hands.
following that, we're now looking at something that Brian would use occasionally to great effect. Sometimes he would use these big delays to give himself a big ambient sound, and a couple of notable uses for that would be when he was doing the Brighton Rock solo live, or when he would do Stone Cold Crazy in the studio. There's also just a bit of EQ there that I added in to come right after those big delays, whenever they're on, so it's only active when those delays are on. I added a touch of 4.7K, as you can see, just to retain a bit more of the brightness as well when those big delays are active. But it's just kind of more for the purpose of bringing the level up, because when those delays are on, because they're at such a high mix, the original dry signal gets lowered a bit. In terms of the Stone Cold Crazy solo, it kind of pushes his sound into a chaotic state, which is quite appropriate for the track, to be honest. So let's take a listen to that. I've got another stereo delay here, which I'm using for a more kind of regular ambience on some solos. An example is what you heard on the intro for this video, which is the I Want It All solo sound. It's not an extreme delay, it's just, as I say, for a bit of general ambience. And finally, just to cap off the ambience, I suppose. I'm not sure why I keep saying that. But yes, just to cap it off, a little tiny bit of plate reverb just to take away from the immediate sort of harsh dryness of the sound.
So I just want to wrap it all up by reiterating the fact that, you know, a guitar tone that works in a band context is very important if you want to be heard and give yourself a powerful, or seemingly powerful, sound. Finding your place as a guitar player in the band's frequency spectrum is so important. Don't forget, what might sound good at home when you're playing by yourself may not translate to the stage. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like and subscribe to the channel, so you can catch anything like this that I'm doing, plus anything else that you'll enjoy. As ever, if you're after some one-on-one guitar tuition with me, you can get in touch on my socials, which I have linked, as always, in the description below the video. Until the next one, guys, stay safe out there, stay positive, and stay musical.